Hello, my name is John Reynolds. Welcome to Extraordinary Life Stories. On this episode, I'm talking with Graeme Carling. Graeme is an entrepreneur, investor, philanthropist, a father, and Scotland's largest private residential landlord, along with his wife and business partner, Leanne. Graeme left school with no qualifications, and together with Leanne, they've already acquired several multi-million pound businesses in the UK and managed transactions valued at more than £1 billion. Their family office is the Carling Group. Graeme is a strong supporter of various charities, having pledged £1 million to the disabled and autistic children's charity Caldwell Children. I'm really looking forward to talking with Graeme. Graeme, thank you for joining me.
Thank you for having me, John.
Good to see you again.
Yeah.
Tell me, who is Graeme Carling?
Oh, great question. Who is Graeme Carling? I'm an entrepreneur. I mean, I can tell you who I am now.
Yeah.
I haven't always been this, but I'm an entrepreneur. I'm a father.
Yeah.
I'm a husband. I'm an entrepreneur. I like to think myself as a leader, a doer, and someone that leads by example for my family first of all, and for others. So I think. I like to think that's what I'm. I'm an ambitious guy. I'm a pretty resilient guy. I've been through quite a lot in my life. So,
You've got a proper twinkle in your eye. Yeah. I want to take you back to a young Graeme.
Yeah.
And actually, to find out if you were that ambitious and driven, mm-hmm. Carling, then, or whether that came almost through finding that kind of purpose and entrepreneur side of things and then achieving success. So what did a young Graeme want to be growing up?
Well, that's a great question. I mean, like everybody else, I wanted to be a football player, you know,
sure.
I wanted to be a sportsman and all that stuff. But I was never just good enough. I was always lacking something, whether it was height or pace or something like that. So I just wasn't quite good enough.
Yeah.
But that's clearly what you know everybody wanted to be when you were a young guy living, you know, growing up in Scotland. Look, I think our family, we had a very, we were born in brought up in a council house. My family, they'd done the traditional thing. They just left school, went and got a job and earned some money. And that was kind of the vision or the cycle that I was brought up in. And for me, I didn't ever wanted to do that. I didn't know what I wanted to do, but I knew what I didn't want to do. That terrified me, going and doing what my dad had done and my granddad had done and my family had all done, that was the life that you just had. It was, there was a blueprint for you. So
it's a real parallel to me. So effectively it was get your grades and go and get a job.
You go and get a job.
That scared me too. So did you do that? Did you do what you were advised to then find out that you really didn't want to do that?
Well, I didn't get the grades. That was the problem.
Okay.
But I still left school and went and got a job. I started, I was delivering milk when I was 13 years old in the morning at 4:30 in the morning. So I was always
entrepreneurial.
Yeah, I was always wanting to earn my own money. Always wanted to, have my own rather than being reliant on others all the time. So I was working from 13. I remember they opened the first McDonald's in Scotland in Dundee where I lived. When I was 15, I got a job there when it first opened.
Yeah.
Then I got, I didn't like school. I had no interest in it. I didn't like what they were teaching me. I wasn't going to go to university. That just wasn't something that we'd done in our family. So the sooner I could get a job and earn some money.
Yes.
So the way that, so how I done what everybody else was doing, not what I wanted to do, but I just went with the flow. And that was how then I became an apprentice joiner on the YTS scheme at the time, £29.50 a week. And I started as an apprentice joiner when I left the school, just at 16 years old, 15, 16. And I hated it, I was hopeless at it. Anything to do practically, I absolutely hated it. But that's just what everybody was doing. So there was no grand plan or ambition. It was just, I didn't know what I wanted to do. So you just went with the flow. And it took me a while to kind of, get my teeth into something that I really enjoyed. But that was doing stuff mentally.
When was that? Because there must have been a moment where that lost feeling, which I can identify with as well, is this really what it's all about? And also potentially a little bit of because of what my parents did in context of
and their parents and so on was go and get a job.
Yeah.
To then go that entrepreneurial route and then have almost like a light bulb moment, like, oh, this is great.
Yeah.
I can forge orders. When did that happen for you? What sort of age and what did you do?
Yeah, so what happened was, and it's very interesting, you just said there, is this what it's all about? Mm. Because we've spoke about, I mean, mental health stuff before and all that. I remember that at that period of time in my life, I remember questioning that. And that was a real worrying concern for me at that time. But I kind of shrugged it off and didn't go too deep into that. But that was a real sort of concern for me. Is this it? You know, is it crikey, for the rest of my life I'm going to be in a joiner or a job for life? Really? Yeah. A job you hate for life? Really? Earning mediocre money and that's it. So,
and people do that as well. I was around certain people that were doing that and you're like, God, that's not me.
No. So what happened was my dad actually had got promoted. My dad was a general manager for a transport company in Dundee. He got promoted to managing director. We moved just as I was 16, just started as a YTS, down to Kent, Herne-Bain, Kent. He got a job in Faversham. And so that was a big move for our family. That was a big move for the extended family because no one had really moved through ambition or promotion before. So we'll probably come on to this, but that was at the time. So we'd moved to Kent. I couldn't get an apprenticeship there as a joiner. Mm. Thankfully, by the way, I wasn't thinking at the time, and I got a job in a transport office working in, and for the first time, I was using my mind. It was just that it was like an admin job to start with, but I really got the bug for it. I thoroughly enjoyed the solving puzzles and problems, and it was a stressful environment. It was fresh food distribution to the supermarkets. It was high pressure stuff, and I really thrived in that environment. Still working for somebody else, but I really, really enjoyed that environment. It didn't solve the problem on working for somebody else and earning mediocre money, but it really gave me the taste. And actually, you know, over the first sort of 3 or 4 years, I progressed through the company, moved to Newport in South Wales, moved up to Manchester. So I'd left my mum and dad in Kent and the family, but I just immersed myself in work. I'm kind of a workaholic. When I really enjoy something, I just get right into it. So during the course of that period, and I was pretty good at it. You know, I was pretty good at solving problems, but still, you know, my bum was twitching. You know, I wanted something extra. This can't be the long term for me, but it was learn what you can. You know, I was enjoying what I was doing, but I still wanted, you know, my mum and dad every year without fail, we'd be arguing at Christmas time. You know, my dad, for as much money as he was earning in the corporate world and going up the ladder, we had no money. Yeah. It was always an argument. There was no money for Christmas. There was no money for summer holidays. My dad was always chasing his bonus, his annual bonus. Then it was huge pressure. So no matter how much money he made, it was spent or was never enough. And I said, you know, there has to be more than this. There has to be. So working for somebody else just didn't make any sense. I had, you know, for me, it was like the only way to break this cycle in my family and just our immediate family was somebody's got to break the cycle. And I thought, right, okay, you know, it's got to be me.
And that's interesting because there's a brave side to that.
Yeah.
And I remember when I first did it, I can remember my grandma saying, I don't understand, what are you being paid? And I said, well, at the moment, I'm not actually being paid anything.
Yeah.
And I remember her face. Got to have a job. You know, I was thinking, well, I'm young enough, I'm motivated enough. And I think this is the key, whether you're young or certain people in their adult life, you sort of mentioned that twitchy bum scenario.
Yeah.
They've got it, but they don't take action.
Yeah.
So many people would love to be their own boss. And maybe there's a confidence issue. Maybe there's the fact they haven't found their purpose or what they're good at.
Yeah.
What you consistently did was take action and keep searching. Mm-hmm. But what was the catalyst when you actually did that? So you've had that Christmas moment.
Yeah.
Well, this is not the life I want.
Yeah.
I don't want to be an employee, but what did you actually do to take action to become an entrepreneur?
Well, you know, you can call it naivety or bravery. I don't know what you call it, but it happened, yeah. And in actual fact, being naive has been one of our strengths because we've taken a naive decision that probably if we'd known more about it, we'd never have done.
I'm going to come
on
to
that. Have came off.
Yeah.
Some of them have came off for us, so I quite like that. But I down here in London, when I was working in Kent, I sat my diploma in logistics at London College. I think it was fashion here, and it was a weird place to have it, but I'd done my diploma in logistics, and the thesis I'd done was the advent of home shopping and internet home shopping. This was 1999. Yeah. And I'd done all the analysis on how it had taken off over in the US with Webvan, Peapod, and some of the, not so much the supermarkets, but how internet grocery shopping had taken off using the internet, and some big companies had boomed at the back of it. So I was pretty clued up in that. You know, I'd immersed myself. I was so intrigued by internet, grocery shopping. We were doing fresh food delivery. That was the background I was involved in. So when the supermarket started, very early days in doing, there were some companies here. Food Fairy in London was one of the first ones in. I don't think they're about now. It was before the supermarket started doing deliveries to in any scale anyway, before Ocado and Waitrose and all that stuff. So, but I was pretty clued up on all of that. So I've seen an opportunity to supply, to look at possibly doing the deliveries on behalf of the supermarkets, and particularly in Scotland, where the geography is a lot greater than the density in the major cities in London. So whilst I was still working, I spoke to Sainsbury's, Tesco's, Asda, Safeway, Morrison's at the time. Anyway, so I was still working, done a bit of work, spoke to these guys, and we got a contract with Tesco's to do some deliveries for them from their stores in Scotland. I think they gave us 7 stores. So I didn't have any money, didn't have any vans. I managed to convince a company to lease us some vehicles, and that was it. So it was an opportunity that came up. And the thing, you know, ultimately it failed after, I think, maybe 9 months or something, because overnight, Tesco's took everything in-house. We didn't have any contract. We were wiped out, you know, like that. And, you know, we didn't have enough capital. There's so many lessons in it. But that was my first venture into it. And I think the problem I had was, you know, we were, you know, every single, the naivety is what we're saying there. I quit my job, but I hated my job.
Yeah.
So it wasn't that hard, other than I'm skint. You know what I mean? Yeah. We need to watch what's going on here. But we've managed to, you know, get some, we got the fuel, we got vans, everything sort of on account.
Yeah.
And that got us in the game.
What I like as well is you took the risk.
Yeah.
And you realised you didn't kind of die from it. You know what I mean? If anything, and this is the key thing that we talked about before, and I absolutely want to open up now, is you learned from it.
Yes.
You ultimately failed.
Yes.
But did you?
Yeah.
Because you didn't get your grades at school. That didn't allow you to do perhaps what you would have done. And maybe you'd have then gone on and got a job.
Yeah.
And then, you know, you could have been the age you are now going, I wonder if.
Yes.
How many people are doing that?
Yeah.
Talk to me about failure and your relationship with it, because so many people talk about success, and there is so much success that you have had since that initial failure.
Yeah.
But it's more embraced now. People are talking about failure more than success, particularly self. What is it about failure that we learn from when we get stronger?
Well, that's where you really get the lessons. That's when you get the physiological, you know, changes in your body when, you know, a disaster. Mm. You know, you're on the edge. You know, the pressure that you go under. You can't get that in a book. You can't get that. The only way to get and build up, you can't second guess yourself. We all think we'll deal with certain situations and circumstances, but until you really go through them, really, you know, you're in the midst of it, you really don't know. So I think, I mean, I say one, like to my son now, fail fast. You know, I wish I had done it. You know, I'd went and sort of worked my way up the corporate ladder for a few years. That I called, they were bum wasted years. I should have started the business, you know, right away, as soon as I can, and to get the lessons early on.
So I have that same thing. But then did we learn what you're saying? It's almost like that sort of no pressure, no diamonds, right?
Yeah. You
know, but in that pressure period where I know how frustrated I was and how, back to that whole, is this really life?
Mm-hmm.
It was almost like a coiled spring when I started to find purpose and started to actually enjoy. It was almost like that. I surged forward, waking up in the morning, absolutely bright-eyed, bushy-tailed, wanting to get out and take the day on, the week on.
Yeah.
If I hadn't had that period,
yeah,
dare I say, would I have had that? I'd like to think I would, but maybe that period was needed for those reasons, even though you see it as a waste of time because you're so good at output now.
Yeah.
You mentioned your son. You know, for me, the current education curriculum is archaic. Mm. It's actually designed to bring through employees.
Well, that's not current. That's forever. Well, I mean, that is the system that's always been there.
I mean, when did we last use a Bunsen burner? Right?
Yeah,
you know, and yet there's financial literacy, there's self-development, which we'll come on to. But So it feels to me like you and your partner in business and your wife, Leanne, are bringing up your kids and have been bringing up your kids to be entrepreneurs. And almost like you said it right at the beginning, leading by example. Because you don't get taught that in school. Is that very much the truth?
It's definitely the truth. And that's probably, if I look at, you know, I was, when I started my first business, second business, third business, that all ultimately failed from, you know, to the smaller businesses, and it was one after the other. It was, I had no guidance. I really had no clue. But I knew that I wanted to do that. So I needed to find my way. You know, my family, my dad, you know, my dad was the person that inspired me in terms of he dared to have ambition, to leave the housing scheme, to leave the environment that he was, that his life was brought up in. Nobody left. You stayed there, or you moved to along the road and you worked in a job and that was your life. You know, you went to the local social club every Saturday.
Routine.
And that was his life. He dared to leave that. So he showed me the way to, he dared to have ambition, but he was not my mentor in terms of an entrepreneur, because he'd never done it before. He'd only ever worked as an employee, done well at it in corporate world, but had never done what I had done, and in terms of taking the leap. His view was he couldn't leave his job once he got to a certain age. And again, another thing for me, I'm 50 now. I remember my dad was 50. There was no way he could leave his job because he had three kids. And my view was, there's no way I'm going to go and be like him, because I'm going to have kids. Yeah. I need to do the absolute opposite, have this battle that they were having, and he was going to have for the rest of his life, and did have, no matter how much money he was earning, it was gone. You know, there was nothing.
Because you can be inspired by how not to do it.
Yes.
So talk about mentors, because I know that's a key part, and we'll come to kind of what you and Leanne do with the Carling Group, where you're prolific investors. How much of that kind of giving back, where you didn't have that guidance, you made those mistakes, that if someone had been there, and dare I say, you'd either sort them out, or they'd sort of been there to help you, how much of that comes naturally, because you also got that philanthropy side of you as well, with the charity, what you do, but just from a business point of view first, how much of that do you give back and enjoy?
Well, we love it. I mean, when we first started, really things going favourable for us, and really we were starting to make progress and have a relative, relatively successful, and started going, we wanted to share that with everybody that we knew.
Yeah.
You know, the problem was they're still there, and we're here mindset wise. It was very, very difficult. So we took, and it felt like we were trying to push it down people's throats. You know what I mean? Oh, look, do this, and there, you should do that. And that had the absolute opposite effect of what we really wanted it to do. So we took the decision after a couple of years, look, we're not going to say anything now. We're just going to, the way that we'll make the biggest impact on the people that we love and want, our family and friends, and if they want it, and the wider community, is by to continue doing what we do and leading by example and doing it, not trying to push it down people's throats. And that's worked, because more and more people now are interested. When you're successful, they ask questions now, rather than us trying to, to sort of not push it down people's throats.
You get so enlightened by something. I've had this with my kids with certain podcasts I've listened to, and they get really excited about it. And almost that self-development in kids. Oh, dad, I don't want to listen to this, I don't want to watch. And you're there like, let's talk about, for example, keeping mentally and physically fit.
Yeah.
You know, I'm sort of encouraging them to, they do their sport, but we've got a gym at home. So, you know, maybe start the day with a bit of the Pilates reformer we've got, or the gym itself, or go for a run and so on. I've noticed they're both teenagers, so it's tough right now. But just almost overbearing with the whole, like, I know how important that is to me. I'd love to start with a kind of morning workout and so on. And then I feel like I'm being too overbearing because I'm pushing it on them, and they're not interested. So I just go on with it myself now. And I've noticed now that they're starting to just come back in to doing that, because I'm not sort of saying you should do it, and then making them feel bad. You don't know workout, they know that.
Yeah.
That disappointment element.
Yeah.
Reverse psychology.
Reverse psychology, yeah.
Flip that to you. So a lot of successful people, they kind of almost swear by having an early morning routine. I'm up at 5, I run a marathon and read a book by 8 o'clock kind of thing. Mm-hmm. Where do you sit with that?
Well, listen, you know, I don't get, I see all that stuff, and I see people that are, you know, absolutely disciplined and obsessed by it and all that. I don't know if you can live your life like that forever, you know, but ultimately, yes, we get up at a certain time, we go for a walk in the morning, we have it, we've planned our day out, and we try to get the maximum we can out of the day. Things happen, you juggle it. We'd like to get, you know, if we're going out, we're going boxing or doing our training, we like to get out the road early if we can. But it doesn't always work like that. We don't hang ourselves for it. No. But as long as we get it done, you know, at some point, yeah. We have an element of flexibility in our day. So I some people need that. Certainly we need to do certain things within a day. But we're not going to hang ourselves up and up at 4:30 in the morning.
But the plan is there. There's a desire to have a goal and be planned. I think I got into a routine that worked really well for me for probably 2 years and then started to sort of shift it and change it.
Yeah.
And then I was really hard on myself for it because I know that worked for me at the time. But actually, there's an element of evolving and changing. Yeah. And actually, that's probably a key question in terms of what, you know, sort of works for you physically and mentally. There's certain things you sort of swear by, you know, the walk in the morning, which I think, hearing the birds tweeting and getting some sunlight, right?
Yeah.
Is that a constant regardless?
That's an absolute one. And so it's first thing, no matter now, obviously, being based in Dubai now,
it's easier
because you're shorts and t-shirt lowering and you're not thinking about the weather or any of that stuff. And in actual fact, you know, with the time differences, depending on the time of the year, you've got to get up earlier anyway because it gets too hot. So you've got to, so that's good. So that kind of keeps you within a certain good routine, good start to the day.
Yeah.
That's a must have. And, but we like to be ahead of the game as well. You know, we like to get up early and have an earlier start. So, right, what's the plans today? And we've got a bit of work done before, if you like, the rest of the people start working. So we like that. We don't like chasing our tails, you know. If we're going to the US, for example, we're doing business there. That's a nightmare, you know, especially when you're on the West Coast.
Sure.
Because you're it's a catch up of a full day, and we don't
brutal.
We don't like that, you know.
Yeah,
we,
I've never worked out a solution to get over that. You do it a lot. Yes, let me know. I've tried all sorts. it's tricky, and I think using that kind of scenario of evolving and changing, purpose seems to be a constant thing that if you look at the lost, you know, people that we were younger to then finding what drove, motivate, you know, in context of purpose right now, what would you say is your purpose and how important is it?
You know, I think you asked the question, when did you find it? When did you find your way? There has to be more than this. It kind of just evolved over time. And in actual fact, there's been not just one milestone, there's been multiple milestones, and it keeps coming. Then, you know, we'll go and we always say everything comes at 90 degrees. So you think that's what you're doing, that's where you're going, that's the plan. But in actual fact, it's here.
Yeah.
That's your purpose.
You need to be going there?
Yeah,
to find
you need
that?
To be.
I think
it's
the whole you've got to keep moving.
You've got to keep moving.
Don't call it woke, but there's an element of people out there that are like, you know, my life's rubbish. You know, I've got no motivation. I don't know what to do. But they're actually potentially standing still, right?
Yeah.
Whereas it feels like you've always kept moving, which hence having those multiple failures, as you said.
Yeah.
To then, if you stand still, if you're not searching, if you're not being curious, then you're not going to have that moment where you're like, I thought it was there.
Yeah.
Oh my God, it's over there.
Well, you see that. I mean, so many people say, well, I'm just going to sit on the sidelines at the moment. Interest rates have gone up, you know, cost of living, inflation, blah, 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 blah. I'm just going to sit on the sidelines. Going, why?
Yeah.
Why are you sitting? You need to keep moving.
Yeah.
You know,
you
can't lose the momentum.
Yeah.
You know, it might be, you know, and something will come up. If you keep going, something will come up in the space. And we just believe that.
Yes.
And normally something does come up that you weren't expecting, or there's an opportunity over here that you've never seen, because the space is there. But as soon as you stop, for me, and I've seen that over the years, it's very dangerous.
I've been guilty of it. I mean, ashamed to admit it, but in business, you know, I was cookie cutting a certain point with Titan Property, that the office to resi permitted development legislation.
Yes, yeah.
Just thought that would go on a lot longer than it did, and it got tricky with surveyors not enjoying that and so on. And it was, I don't want to say it was laziness, but it was that whole, I'll just do this for a bit and actually do some other things and take some time with the family. And then instantly the world's changed around you. So that whole comfort zone where dreams go to die is definitely something that I've Mm-hmm. I've experienced. But on the flip side, back to yourself, you know, by keeping on moving, by keeping on going, you've achieved phenomenal success. I think you and Leanne have invested over $1 billion now in a different investments.
Well, we've done, we've done over that in deals, you know, over. I mean, we were speaking to someone yesterday. I mean, it's been probably 17, 18 years we've been going down. Yeah. We're going, wow, that's gone so quickly. And we just saw it's, you know, it's taken. But when you get the momentum, you've got to keep the momentum going.
I really feel that for me. It's inspiring. Mm. But sitting here now, with that level of success, what is your definition of success?
If I look at my life, so it's not just business or anything. We've managed, in the time that I've known Leanne and we've been together, we have built a substantial business together. Yeah. We've wonderful kids. We travel the world. We are financially, you know, have been for years free and okay. And we've managed, our kids have grown up with us. I think we've been good role models to them as well. So from a family point of view, not just to them, to my extended family who I don't see so much, but I know that ultimately I am the person that continues to break the trend because they're still doing the same stuff. But they're now asking questions and are more motivated now than ever. And others, we've inspired others.
Yeah.
And we will continue to do that. So there's for us, you know, in terms of end game, there's no end game. We want to do more of the same because where we are at the moment, we're in a great place. Yeah. So there's not like an end. And we'll never stop, by the way. It's not
I can tell.
No, we're no chance. You know,
You've got it. You're absolutely pumped with energy. And what I love as well, and this is something I've learned to embrace, is you haven't got a set goal where it's like, well, you mentioned the billion, we're after 2 billion.
Yeah.
You mentioned this. Yeah. It's enjoying the journey. It's being present.
Yes.
It's being present in the moment. Mm. How many people are missing that? Uh-huh. And I love the fact that you're in business as well as being married with Leanne.
Yeah.
Because I could see that in some context, relationship with that could be pretty brave. That could be a risk. Mm-hmm. You know, spend too much time to need to have that separation. Yep. Mm-hmm. But when you just said the whole, like you go on holiday together, you're probably constantly talking about deals together. Well, what do you think about that to the kids and so on and to Leanne? The whole thing of actually nurturing, mentoring, as well as parenting, it seems to work really well for you.
It does. You know, we met at work. We've only ever known working together.
Yeah.
And I think at times in your life, you know, I'd had failed businesses, I'd stuff, I didn't have, you know, I've helped to recover from failed businesses before I started again. And someone or something comes into your life that just creates that spark and momentum. And ultimately, that's what happened with me and Leanne. You know, we came into each other's life. And then things started to make sense. And that's ultimately where it has been. We have, for our kids, they've been brought up in the business world. We have one life.
Yeah.
And it's not like we're switching on and off. And it's just one life. And we absolutely love it.
Yeah, so, I can tell. It's constant. A couple more questions because I could talk to you for so long. The Carling Group, in terms of how it's set up, I mean, you're almost like your kind of dream deal and maybe an example of a couple of opportunities that you've got involved in that you're really passionate about.
Yeah.
Give me a feel for that.
Well, a couple that we're working on at the moment. Leanne particularly likes healthcare. Anything that has a global opportunity, a global market.
So
global
scale is really important.
Scale is huge for us now. Again, we weren't always this. We just wanted to get enough money to not have to go back to, you know, a just over broke job. You know, that was it. But now our ambitions are so much higher. Anything that's scalable globally. So healthcare, Leanne particularly likes the healthcare sector, renewable energy. You know, we're pretty good. You know, we're pretty involved in that field here and in the US now. UK and US, and I particularly like, there's a project we're working on at the moment in the AI space. Again, it's a tech product. I can see, it has the potential for to be the next unicorn and all that stuff. But that aside, you know, people are so fearful of AI and what it's going to do.
Yeah.
The potential this could add to humanity. It is really exciting for me. It's something that we've never done before, but we're actually pretty far down the road with this one. So that's a really exciting project, scalable, global, futuristic, all of that stuff. So
exciting.
Yeah, that's what I
think that it parallels your character well, because there's people that run away from their fears, run away from a challenge, whereas you're the opposite in life, right?
Yeah.
You know, there's a mountain to climb, I'm going to climb it.
Yeah.
AI terrifies some people.
Yes.
And I can see why in context. But it's also a massive opportunity. Mm-hmm. You know, we can all benefit from it. So if you're the entrepreneurial businessman that can actually say, well, how can we harness that? How can I actually make a difference?
Yeah.
I can see why that, mm-hmm. that makes a big difference. Graeme, I could keep talking to you for ages. Yeah. I've learned so much from you in this conversation. I loved it. Thank you for sharing so much with me.
Thanks, John. Thanks for having me. Cheers. Thank you, mate. Cheers.